Hi there, YouTube. My name is David Kwon, and welcome to an hour of communism. And that's because my last name is Kwon, so that's the tongue-in-cheek joke there. It has nothing to do with, you know, communism as an ideology or anything like that. It's just a lame joke about my last name. This is a video series where I'm going to be talking for an hour about a whole bunch of different things. And these are all my opinions and my thoughts. Why am I doing this? I'm not doing this because I'm a brilliantly smart guy that has expert opinion. I'm just doing this because I mean, simple reason is I want to. I think this is I would like this to be a thing. And what I mean by that is I'm not saying I'm expecting this thing to be huge with lots of viewers and a following. That would be great, but that's not the point. What I mean is I want this to be a thing in that it's a thing for me in my life. I want to be doing this every day, every weekday. So I'm going to be posting a video every Sunday, from Sunday night to Thursday night. Is that how it works? No, so Sunday night to whatever, 5 days. I'm taking 2 days off from doing this. But for 5 days straight, every week, every day, I'll be uploading a video. It's going to be an hour long. It's going to have a format where I talk about different sections, different topics. Anyway, I'm going to be talking for an hour, or just about, maybe a little less, maybe a little more, but I'm going to be talking for an hour. It's a totally unedited thing, so I'm going to screw up, I'm going to mess up, probably somewhere in between, but it's just going to be me talking for an hour. Why not edit it? That's a good question. Honestly, that's because I'm kind of lazy. If I was being paid a lot of money to do this, sure, I will make it, you know, I will try my best to do that. But this isn't for any monetary reason, but it's for my betterment. It's also just to see what it would feel like for me and how it would work out. I would love it for this to be a thing that I keep getting better at. And maybe at some point, you know, if I feel like this is something that I really should invest my time and energy into, I will edit different stuff like that. But for now, I just want to see how I do just talking about different stuff for an hour and seeing how that turns out and seeing if I can just keep the energy and the momentum going to talk about things every day. And I'm planning it to be every day so that I can talk about contemporary stuff or current stuff, because a lot of times the videos that I've had, this is a new channel, I'm starting totally fresh. This is linked to my other Gmail email I have. So it's a totally new channel I have at the when this video is uploaded on this channel. I have no subscribers. This is my first video on this channel. So whoever is the first to view this is the first to view this video on this channel. I'm going to be promoting the hell out of it on my regular channel. But yeah, this is a fresh start, a new thing I'm doing. It's a totally new experiment. I want to see how far I can go with it, and try my best to do my best at it. And yeah, that's pretty much the reason I want to be able to, you know, in the distant future, I want to be able to kind of look back at these videos and be like, I did this. You know, I was able to, you know, every day of the week, every 5 days a week, I got it. I sat behind my computer screen and looked at the webcam and talked for an hour without, you know, talked for an hour and stayed interesting somewhat. That's the plan. So, how each these oh and look, you know, you see me with the tie. That's some effort, right? Maybe a little bit. I don't know. I really like this tie. And so that's another thing I'm promising you. In all these videos, I guess I'll try to look my best. I know it's not much. This is me at my best. But I'll wear a collared shirt, wear a tie, and look pretty presentable. I'm kind of cheating though. I'm wearing jeans. See? So I'm not like, you know, super businessy. I'm not in the business suit. If I was in a job interview and you were interviewing me looking like this, I would probably not get the job. Just saying. And I don't have any clothes that are more expensive than $20 or $30. So, yeah. That said, each of these shows, each of these videos are going to have a specific format. I'm hoping to stick with this format, but I don't know. Maybe future videos will have a different format. But currently, the format I'm hoping to stick to is these are the topics that are going to be in the video. U.S. event, that's probably the first event. So something that happened in the U.S. currently, today or in the recent past, and my thoughts on it. So U.S. event, world event, and then the third topic is entertainment event. So entertainment being, you know, the video game world, movie world, music world, whatever, anything that's kind of luxury or entertainment related news. To me, because I'm a gamer, most of it is going to be just video gaming news. I find them to be the most interesting and the most pertinent to me. But if something happens in, I don't know, in the other entertainment world, that's why I kept it a broad topic, saying it's entertainment. So those three are just contemporary events in those three realms. U.S., you know, because I know it's kind of biased to have just one section for U.S., but I'm in New York, I'm in America, and sorry, that's just my bias there. So U.S. event, world event, and an entertainment event. Those I'm thinking those are going to be pretty staple. And then the fourth topic is going to be an opinion piece. Maybe just a random topic, it doesn't have to be contemporary or whatever. A random topic, and then I'm just going to pretty much spill whatever I think about it at the time. And that's just my opinion. Whether I'm wrong or not, I don't know. I'm gonna pick topics that I don't really know too much about. But I, you know, everyone has opinions, and so do I. So I'm just gonna, you know, bring my opinion to the mix. And then the fifth topic is so something I'm reading. Hopefully a book. But I feel like this fifth topic is optional for me. I don't think this fifth topic will be on every single video that I post on this thing, on the hour of communism. Simply because books take time to read. So I want to be talking about a book, a magazine, or something I read in this thing. Something that's on print. You know, it's not just a website blog, or maybe, you know what, that's an idea. Maybe I'll do a blog sometime, or a short story or book. But something I read and kind of my thoughts on it. For this video, for today's video, I actually do have something I want to talk about. And that is this book, The Morning Miracle. Inside the Washington Post by Dave Kindred. So that will be a section. And then my final section will be about personal things, my life experiences, maybe what I'm doing right now, just me, about me in general. That's my fifth section. So that part is more like a typical vlog, if you will, like a slice. If I wrote a diary and put it in the video form, talking in front of the camera, and you take a slice out of that, that will be the final section of every video that I do. So that's the format. And today, I planned this thing out. I have different things I want to talk about. So the reason I'm doing it this way is, yes, you can see, you will see all these links on here. I'll get to it. If you don't see the links right now, that means you're watching this too early. And I haven't gotten the time to, I haven't gotten around right now to just put the links around. But there'll be links around, and you click on one of the links, it will skip you to the section where I talk about that topic. This way, you don't have to hear me blabber on about everything. If you're not interested in, a specific world event that I want to talk about, skip to, you know, whatever, the U.S. event. Skip to my entertainment event that I want to talk about. Skip to my opinion on a specific topic. Skip to my personal experience or whatever. And that's the plan, that's the format. This is my first video on this thing, so I don't know how I'm going to do it, or, you know, how much of a failure I'll be, how much of a success I'll be, but that's pretty much my introduction, and just the introduction has been 10 minutes alone, so that's not good. Let's get to talking about real topics. Alright, so this hour of communism now begins with a U.S. event, and this U.S. event is, it's not really an event, but more like like a happening or process of happening. And this is based on an article that I read on New York Times. The article is titled, "Taping of Farm Cruelty is Becoming the Crime." And that's pretty much as, that's pretty straightforward. I think in recent times we've seen a lot of viral videos. There's a lot of animal activists out there who goes into undercover into different factory farms or family farms or whatever, and they wear like hidden cameras working, and they capture footages. And that those footages are used by animal rights or animal welfare organizations, or even given to the law enforcement agencies, and to muckrake or to show horrible conditions or just regular conditions, of factory farming. And I think this is really important simply because it just shows what's happening. I think, so before I get into my opinions about things, I guess it is important to note, I do have a strong bias. I am a vegan, or I try as much as I can to be a vegan. Sometimes I fail in that regard, and I'm like a vegetarian. Sometimes I eat, chocolate or something. Doesn't happen very often, but I try to live as much to not consume any animal product. So that's my personal bias here. I'm not gonna try to talk about veganism on this topic too much, but just letting you know that I am vegan. So that's why I was kind of drawn into this news. But even if you're not vegan, if you're not vegetarian, even if you don't want to consider whatever, I think information is very important, especially on the stuff that goes into our body. The stuff that we're eating is really important to consider, simply because eating is one of the most frequent activities that we do as human beings. Most people eat 3 times a day, 4 times a day. We eat to survive, and we need to know, we need to be aware of how this food is made. So that's one thing. But another thing is, if you are consuming meat or dairy or animal products, there is some ethics to be considered. We generally, I think human, this society as a whole is generally a compassion-loving society, generally speaking. I mean, that's not to say there aren't psychopaths out there or sociopaths out there. There are. But generally speaking, I think most people are want to be as compassionate as possible. They want to lead compassionate lives. Whatever. They want to be nice to other people. They want other people to be nice to them. A lot of Americans, so when I mention society, because of my bias, I usually mean America. So I should keep that in mind and kind of say that. In America, there are a lot of people who have pets. So obviously, a lot of Americans, a lot of people in America, love animals. And we eat animals, or a lot of people, a lot of us eat animals. But at the same time, I don't think any of us, I don't think a lot of us actually, want to do as much harm to animals with eating them. So animal welfare is a big concern. A lot of people, I think, when I say I'm a vegetarian, I think some people would argue that like that's not the thing to do. Some people would say, well, I don't think eating animals is wrong, but I think it's the problem is how we treat animals. If you believe that logic, I disagree with you, but if you believe that, let's not go there. If you believe that, then it's important to know how animals are treated in factory farms, So that's why all these undercover work done, I think, is really important. Yes, sometimes they are kind of biased. They kind of always, sometimes some montages of farming, whatever, are only show the worst kinds of things, But sometimes they're not. But this is an interesting point that one of the, I don't know if it's a point brought up, but I guess the agribusiness people, people who own these factory farms, they want to kind of outlaw the taping of farming in animal farms. They want to outlaw the tapes simply because it's too, it gives a wrong impression of a farm operating. Not a lot of people know what's happening inside the farms. So he made this analogy, like, it's like showing a picture of surgery to regular people. And it just is horrific and makes us jump out of our seats like, oh my god, that's gross, you know. And that's a good point, you know, if somebody showed me a footage of a surgeon doing surgery, wow, my terminology is, I'm not very eloquent. So trust me, I'm hoping to get better in this hourly talk, but a surgeon doing surgery, and me seeing a footage of that, it's gonna freak out a lot of people who are not surgeons because it's not pretty to look at. That's the point there, but that's an important point, I suppose. But there are a lot of times, because of the profit motive, because they have to make things so cheap, there are a lot of times where they do violate so many regulations about animal welfare, and people have the right to know. You know, I mean, I know it's their private property, that it shouldn't be filmed, whatever, but it's really interesting that the animal industry or animal farms and factory farms are moving to lobby to outlaw the taping of films and so that they can never be used as evidence, and that will criminalize. So people who are found to have taped, now they have to serve prison terms or pay fines. It's just, that's really irksome to me. I know animal activists who go in there are violating, you know, they are trespassing in some ways. But somebody who went undercover, and by undercover I mean like they applied for a job at a factory farm and got hired as a worker there and were hitting cameras around and stuff. I guess it violates that company policy, but does that, like that's still evidence that's still pertinent. I think it still should be pertinent in a court of law and things of that nature. And it shows a lot. Those kind of footages are what moves people forward and what kind of changes a lot of things in the animal industry and you know, this animal welfare movement, I think, is important and great. So this new development where businesses are trying to outlaw the footages and criminalize taping of farms and factory farms, it's problematic to me. That's pretty much all I will say on that topic. Next topic, world event. So today I want to talk about North Korea because it's a really big topic right now. Kim Jong-un is threatening to launch nuclear missiles and use this missile and attack America. This is this escalating situation. That I don't know. That said, I have to admit, I don't know too much about all this situation. I need to read more into it. I definitely need to kind of watch more, read more, research more on this thing. So my thoughts might not all be that relevant. But then, you know, you might get to thinking, like, you might have this opinion, well, like, you're Korean, like, why, you know? Yeah, I'm Korean, but I live in New York City, so, you know, and I haven't paid attention to too much Korean politics, but I will tell you what I kind of know. What I know, generally, is that every time a new South Korean president is elected, the North Korean government likes to kind of test the waters, and currently, this is a time when both regimes had a regime change pretty like close to each other time-wise. You know, the Kim Jong-il died, this new successor came on, Kim Jong-un. Now he's the head of the North Korean government. He's also very young, and he's inexperienced in politics. That's pretty much what I got out of it. I might be wrong. He might be very experienced in North Korean politics. I don't know. All I know is he's a young guy. He's risen to power pretty recently. Same thing with South Korea. South Korea the presidential election that it had was pretty recent. So South Korea government now has this new president. So both governments had regime changes pretty recently. Every time South Korea government has a regime change, North Korea goes nuts just to test out what happens and to kind of test out the waters and to kind of it's a game of brinksmanship. How far is South Korea willing to go, and how far is North Korea willing to go, and how will that dynamic scare off what kind of reaction will its neighbors, United States, China, and Japan, what kind of reaction will they bring when these two kind of fight it out over this? It's happened every time South Korean government had a regime change. This particular time is much more troubling because this is the first time in South Korean history where a female person or woman was elected president. So right now, the president of South Korea is a woman. Not only that, I didn't know about this until very recently, but this is the daughter of Park Jae-hee, Park Chun-hee, I forgot the name, but the former leader of South Korea in the 1980s. And that leader became the leader of South Korea not by election, but by a coup, a military coup. He was a military leader that did a coup d'etat and became the leader of South Korea and pretty much ruled South Korea under martial law. So he was, it's not fair to say he was like a dictator or a king, but he wasn't a democratically elected president. He kind of got to power with force. And that person's daughter has now become elected president of South Korea. So think of that for a moment. This is a very volatile situation. And then North Korea has recently had a regime change. And this guy, like, maybe he doesn't understand the dynamic of politics all that well. And something new is also with North Korea. They finally actually developed a nuclear material, which they never had before. So now they have something to kind of leverage their threats against. So now their threats seem more pertinent than ever before. Now it's not a matter of do they have nuclear materials, it's a matter of can they deliver it? Do they have the capability of delivering that to where they want it to? And at the current point, what I've been reading is that they don't really, they can't strike anywhere in the United States, except for some part of Alaska is within range, but it's the delivery system would be crappy, so it would be easy to counter. I don't know. Them, North Korea attacking the United States with a nuclear missile, the possibility of that is pretty unlikely. If it does happen, it can be defended easily. That's pretty much what I'm reading right now. Would North Korea be stupid enough to do that? I don't know. This is funny, but I'm going to quote a video game. At the end of Metal Gear Solid, the first one, Gray Fox, a character, says, a cornered jackal is more dangerous than a fox, a royal hound, or I forgot the exact quote. But that's what North Korea is right now. It's cornered. It has so many levels of sanction placed against it. It has all these military powers who are kind of against it. China has kind of stopped giving aid. Russia doesn't give aid. It's a cornered country, and it feels like in order to leverage this authority, it needs to seem like the biggest person in the room with the loudest voice. So that's kind of the situation of North Korea. For North Korea to actually start some kind of, you know, start something with this escalation, politically for them, it's not to their benefit. It would be a stupid move. But it would just be horrific. That doesn't mean that North Korea would lose, because the thing is, I don't know, it's a very dangerous situation. I hope I'm right on this, but it's just North Korea kind of testing out the waters because of regime change. I hope that's the thing, and I feel like that's what I'm leaning towards. That is kind of just a game of brinksmanship, and nothing will happen out of it. But if something does happen, this is like in every scenario that like I kind of imagine, it's just like this is how World War III would start with North Korea. What I know is that North Korea is one of the most militarized nations in the world. They have about 1 million troops ready to serve because of their conscription laws, what have you. And the most scary thing is that South Korea and North Korea will be just brutally devastated if something does break out. And what scares me is that something might break out not because it was intended, but because of something, some kind of escalation like, oh, North Korea threatens South Korea, you know, U.S. responds back with the threat, and it just keeps escalating until somebody accidentally does something, and boom, it blows over and it starts something totally insane, totally crazy. Like, this is a horrible analogy, but the American Revolutionary War is written to have started with a gunshot that rang around the world. There was a group of people, like there was the British Army and the colonial militias, like standing on both sides like this, guns pointed at each other. And then, I don't know, the legend or the myth is maybe this is a different battle, but somebody was just like, do not shoot. But instead of hearing not, it was heard shoot. Gunshot was fired, and everybody just started firing each other, and that was the beginning of a war. The historians can't say, don't know which side fired first or who fired first. All we know is that someone fired a gunshot, and that was the beginning of this massive war. And it happened. Maybe I'm thinking of Civil War, but I don't know. There was one war that was started out like that in American history. I'm scared it might happen here. I'm scared like somebody might make a mistake and just all of a sudden it's just a total bloodbath. What is so scary about this situation is that North Korean military is known to be experts at trench warfare, at digging, and tunnel warfare. Just like North Vietnam. North Vietnam had a system of underground bunkers and tunnels, and people could live there, survive. It's like they had an own underground city. So in the Vietnam War, in the early 70s to mid, in the mid 60s to early 70s, United States and South Vietnam started this aerial bombing campaign. They took their F-145s, or I forgot the name of the plane, but the Thunderbolt planes. They sent them to over the skies of North Vietnam and just bombed the hell out of the place. Just massive carpet bombing, napalm bombing, just bombed the hell out of the place. But North Vietnam was not that affected, the military, because they lived underground. The bombs didn't reach them underground. It just destroyed everything on the surface. North Vietnam and North Koreans share that similarity, except North Koreans, from what I've read, are better engineers underground. They have these massive tunnel systems. Tanks can fit in it. Jeeps can fit in it. And they have 1 million soldiers ready to use this underground tunnel network. And last time I looked on this was like 2009. South Korean government found an exit. And they were able to dispose of it. But tunnel exits that exited right behind Seoul. Right inside South Korea from North Korea. And they destroyed it. 5 tunnel exits, and they estimate that there's like 7 or 8 more left to be discovered. And North Koreans have built these tunnels so well that South Koreans detecting technology that like uses these weird devices to detect seismic wave signatures. These North Korean tunnels are built so well that it's able to evade those devices and fool those devices. So imagine a war breaking out. North Korean tanks and troops come out of this tunnel and corner Seoul, and United States gets involved with this bombers and planes, and oh my gosh, I can't imagine that happening. That would just be awful and awful and again, awful. I really wish that doesn't happen. And my money is on it not happening. My money is that this will just kind of blow over. But yeah, it's a pretty volatile situation. Honestly, I cannot think of any solution to how to deal with North Korea. Simply because if you become much harsher on them, then, you know, North Korea becomes this country that's cornered and does more things that, you know, we have to fight back. Maybe war is necessary. Maybe that's something that has to happen, even though the thought of that is terrifying to me. Maybe a war with North Korea has to happen. If it does, a lot of people are gonna die. Both sides, not both sides, all sides. It's gonna be a massive blood war. It has a potential for inciting World War III. That's how I'm seeing it. Just because there are so many countries tied into this one little peninsula. United States has, you know, a treaty that obligates them to kind of be there. China is terrified of what happens there because it's in their borders. There's too many countries tied into this. This is, if it goes wrong, it's bound to be World War III. And that's a horrible implication there. I don't know, it's terrifying. But then, if we are, like, you know, if we're friendly and peaceful and negotiating to North Korea, that only makes things worse also, because then North Korea, you know, kind of secretly develops much more harmful things. And it's not the type of government that's like, oh yeah, you're being nice to us, now we're, you know, gonna be nice to our people. It's a very sexist government. It's a corrupt government where the officials have all the power. That, you know, it's the worst case of socialism and communism just gone wrong. It's like the worst fascist, Nazis, I don't know, just that government where the leader of that country is viewed as a god. And he's the leader of the religion of that country is the political party of that country. That is North Korea. And, you know, South Korea in the past have, you know, kind of given its food so that, you know, North Korean people won't be poor. But that food doesn't go to the poor of North Korea. It's spread among the party officials of North Korean government. So, honestly, I don't know. I don't see any logical solution to this other than eventually there might be war. And yeah, terrifying. Like I said, I don't know too much about this. This is just what I know and my thoughts on it. I don't have enough knowledge to propose any useful solutions other than just my observations there. So those are my observations on that topic. Pretty serious topic, and this is why I spent a lot of time talking about that topic. Next topic is, let's talk about a lighter topic, but it could still get us mad. In the entertainment world, in the gaming world, the recent development is there's a lot of rumors about the next Xbox, and which is understandable because PS4 was recently announced and Microsoft hasn't responded at all to that kind of announcement. So there's all these rumors about what the next Xbox might be like. Some of those rumors seem legit. Some of those rumors have the same kind of sources as the rumors about PlayStation 4. And many of those rumors turned out to be true about PlayStation 4. So a lot of these rumors might be true. And there's, of course, the rumor is that the next Xbox will require an always online connection. What does that mean is kind of debatable. Does that mean that, you know, it would just automatically download in the background if the system is turned off? It'll just automatically download updates and stuff or games in the background, even if it's in a sleep mode, whatever. Or does that mean that the system, and this is the debatable part, this is what people get up at arms about, and I think they should, that the device won't work unless it's connected to the internet. It has to be always connected to the internet for it to function even. So that's the problem here. And people are like, oh no, like that happens, I'm, you know, switching or just giving up on Xbox as a whole. There's two things here that I want to kind of talk about. The first thing is, the first thing is, I think people should be as vocal about this as possible, and I feel like there should be a huge backlash. I fear that there won't be. That's my thing. If Microsoft does this, that there's an always-on connection, I don't think the backlash will be significant enough or impactful enough. But I really feel like this is the issue that people need to kind of, because I don't want the Xbox to not work. That's just wrong to have this hardware device not function simply because there's no internet connection. So that's my thing. I want there to be as much vocal negativity about this as much as possible if Microsoft does that. Here's the second thing. My opinion is that Microsoft will do this. And this is where I pretty much disagree with a lot of people who kind of brought this up about this issue. I think Microsoft will be okay. I think they'll still be successful with the next Xbox, even if they do this. And Microsoft is not a government entity that has to please everyone, that has to serve everyone. It's a corporation. If PlayStation decided to do this always online thing, it'd be the same exact thing. But Microsoft has a vested interest in its online consumers. When you compare something like Xbox Live to PlayStation Plus, both require fees, annual fees to have. But it's a totally different thing. Xbox Live's Gold membership is so much more profitable for Xbox Live, because all they have to do is upkeep server maintenance costs. They just keep Xbox Live functioning the way it is, and they reek in money. People are paying $60 a year or $50 a year, however much money a year, not because of the features or whatever. They're paying to play online and then the features that come with it. The main reason they pay is to be able to play online. So Microsoft doesn't even have to do much, you know. They just keep the server costs up, which is pretty cheap, and it's a whole bunch of profit there. PlayStation Plus is people pay money not to play online, but for discounts and for free games. Well, for Sony to make sure that's possible, that costs a lot of money. That means paying developers or publishers of a game company like, hey, we're gonna make your game free on our service. We're gonna pay you this much amount of money to make that possible. So it's not as cheap for Sony to be able to do PlayStation Plus. Whereas Microsoft is just like, these are online customers. If we only care about our online customers and not care about people who don't have internet access, what doesn't matter, because we're still having so much profit. It's a waste of money, and that's what their mind will be thinking, to go out and try to reach out to every single person out there who can play games. And they're thinking at it looking like, if Microsoft is able to convince people that, hey, you know, this is an entertainment service like Netflix, like Hulu, like OnLive, all these services I mentioned require an internet connection. You can't, you know, I have a Netflix app on my iPhone, but I can't use it without internet. OnLive, you know, it's in my computer. I open up the app. If I'm not connected to the internet, I can't play games. It's as simple as that. If Microsoft is able to convince its consumers that it's just like any of those services where you need internet in order to whatever, it won't be an issue. And as long as Microsoft has its content to back it up, it won't be an issue. There will still be people flocking out to buy the next Xbox. How can Microsoft convince this? This is where I think if Microsoft was smart and evil, kind of, you know, evil people are smart, but that's why I'm saying, that's why the first thing I mentioned, people have to be vocal. There has to be a significant amount of backlash for this not to happen. But if it does happen, there is a pretty strong chance, in my belief, that Microsoft will be fine, will still be massively successful. If Microsoft does this, if Microsoft treats the next Xbox like a cable box, like, let's say, hey, the next Xbox costs $50 or $100. You know, the speculation, PS PlayStation 4 or Wii U can be, the cheapest point it can be is like $300, $400. That's still a lot of money, but that's the cheapest it can get, you know? If Microsoft was just like, hey, our console costs $100. That's all you have to pay for our next console. People are going to be like, whoa, that is super cheap. How is that possible? Well, you have to sign a 2-year contract with us. If you agree to pay for our Xbox Live Gold for 2 years and stick with that, you know, pay $120, you know, pay $60 a month, $60 a year or $5 a month for 2 years or 3 years, your next Xbox is $100. So it's like what phone companies do, what Verizon does, or what AT&T does with like expensive phones. My iPhone is a $600 phone. Did I pay $600 for my phone? No, I paid $200. Why? Because I had a 2-year contract with Verizon. If Microsoft does this, oh my gosh, like, the possibility of them being able to convince people that it's just like Netflix or it's just like on live, is very possible. So, my point is, if Microsoft is a smart corporation that could make this happen. So I feel like people arguing that, like, if Microsoft does this, it's a total failure for them. People are just gonna not stop supporting Microsoft. I hope you do. I hope you really do just stop supporting Microsoft. I hope there's enough people that do that so that this doesn't happen. Because I don't, like I said, I don't want an always-on console. But I don't, I have a negative outlook. I'm pretty pessimistic that Microsoft will do this. It will be always online. It will be treated like a cable box with two-year contracts. And people are going to buy it. Because when you look at it, like, hey, $100 console, $450 console, which is more appealing in this economic time? Yeah, you'll be tied down for 2 or 3 years, but $100 versus $450 or $400 or $300. Simple math there. So that's my opinion on that topic. Wow, I talked a lot. I don't think I'll get to my opinion topic. Let's just skip to talking about this book. I'll talk about rape tomorrow. that's so weird to say. Tomorrow, stay tuned for rape discussion. Yes. Fifth topic. This is the book I read, Morning Miracle, Inside the Washington Post by Dave Kindred. Wow, it's an interesting book. It's a book about the Washington Post and how it's transitioned into this space, the struggles of a newspaper struggling to remain relevant and remain profitable, and the difference that happened wise. And in a way, this book, I think it kind of overly glorifies the olden days of newspaper journalism. But at the same time, I could totally understand that. This book really inspires me. Like, I wish I had the talent to be, or I wish I had the talent and the drive to be a newspaper journalist or a newspaper reporter. Those people, I'm going to make a video on my other channel about jobs I admire. And newspaper journalist is one of those jobs. It's a job I really, really admire. You know, a lot of these people sacrifice, go out of their ways, you know, to the detriment of their health, sometimes risking their lives for that story that needs to be told, for that truth that needs to be told to the American public. And a lot of the times, these important stories change laws, change society for the better, because we know the truth, and truth is powerful. So it does glorify that kind of old journalism, and it focuses on four different stories that won Pulitzer Prizes. And it's a story about how this one section in the military base, a lot of people who have mental depression coming from Iraq were put into this, I forgot the name of the place, but put into this place without any really care or any thought. And then the treatment of these soldiers who returned from Iraq with mental disorders was awful. And one reporter went into this base because she had a source that just kind of called her up, called Core about it. And it was two journalists, actually, not just her. So two journalists went in there and just started, you know, being like, hey, we're here to visit our friend. And they just let them in. So it was a very lax security system. They went in, they interviewed people and found out the truth. And they did the whole expose on the Washington Post. And that won a Pulitzer Prize. That kind of investigative journalism is something to really admire. And I feel like all newspapers, you know, they're really important and necessary in a society. The trouble is with the rise of internet, and anyone can post their opinion or news or blog site or whatever. And people's attention span has gotten shorter. You know, you post a 4-5 page news article, it doesn't get read that much anymore because people would rather like to read short blurbs or blogs or whatever. So the old model of these long form pieces have become unfortunately irrelevant. So this nature of you know, newspapers staying relevant and staying profitable. It's what's focused in this book, and it's you know, I feel like I still don't. After reading 250 pages of this, the whole world of newspaper journalism is still totally a mystery to me. But it did pique my interest. I definitely want to read, want to know more about how it works and the people behind it. And you know, it piqued my interest. It's a really interesting read. I hope I get the chance whenever I can to kind of get a more updated version, because this was released and published in 2009, I think. So it's not as relevant today, but it's really interesting how newspapers have struggled with the advent of internet. And the personalities behind these, the newspaper Washington Post, is pretty inspiring. One of the, a lot of it is glorification or kind of, you know, raising up these people to a pedestal and to some degree. But the CEO, Don Graham, like before this post as CEO, as this position was kind of a given to him. It was expected, like, you know, he could just walk in and grab it. But he didn't do that. When he graduated from Harvard, I think, he could have just went into this newspaper business and just kind of taken the CEO position. But instead of doing that, he went and joined the army. And he did that. And then after serving his term and having an honorable discharge, he became a cop in Washington, D.C. And that was to prove himself, you know, that he wanted to learn about the city that he was going to be writing about or having a journalistic responsibility over. So there's this guy who didn't have to prove to anyone but himself that this is something that he had to do. He was a cop for like 2 years doing pretty much like being in like really poor cities and, you know, just doing cop work for a while until eventually he came into the newspaper, not as a CEO, but as a reporter. And then he did almost every different job in the newspaper business before finally become the CEO and the head of it. So I thought that was really interesting and really inspiring, you know. And it's really interesting that Dave Kindred constantly pushes this point that the most important job of a managing editor or of a publisher, someone like Don Graham, the CEO, the most important thing that person is doing is hiring of the managing editor. Who he hires is so important to how the newspaper functions. And he hired Len Downey. And Len Downey is like the exact opposite of Don Graham. He didn't have the position granted. Like, it wasn't like something he would inherit. But he was kind of born poor. He had to work his way up. So here is this guy. I love this contrast between this guy who didn't have to prove anything, but did his best to prove to himself that this job was his. And then here's this guy who was born poor with like, but he had to prove to everyone else that he could do it, that he was capable. And so he hired this guy, who was at the time an investigative reporter, to be the managing editor. And that was, I think that's an incredible story. That's an incredible story. It's a pretty thought-provoking read for me, just thinking about newspaper journalism as a whole and where it's gotten. It kind of ends on a pessimistic note, saying that newspaper is the demand for the truth, demand for the information is always going to be there. But the question of who's going to deliver it and how we're going to deliver it and whether that, how much, like what kind of profit model or, you know, money model, economic model is there in that delivery, that's the biggest question about the new world of newspaper. And the pessimistic note is that now, like the way journalism works, now there is so much corporate influence in the newspaper world that sometimes the truth has a slant, biased slant, because, you know, different corporate interests have kind of tainted it. So that's kind of the pessimistic feel I got about it. I really wish, I don't know if they Maybe I should look it up. I will definitely look it up if David Kindred updated his edition of this book and updated to include kind of what's happening in the newspaper world about Washington Post in 2013, 2012. You know, that would be pretty awesome. So now we come to the final topic of this hour of communism, and that's about my life. So currently I am unemployed. I am just volunteering at Housing Works twice a week. I volunteer every Tuesdays and every Fridays, helping them prepare for this fundraising event that they do every year. The fundraising event will occur on April 25th. It's Design on a Dime, and it's a fantastic event that happens every year. It's an event where 60 of the city's top designers have these spaces, these interior design spaces with really high-end furniture, high-end couches, sofas, tables, decorative art, home accents, lamps. Like, some of these lamps cost like $2,000 or $300, like a ridiculous amount of money. These are really expensive stuff, and it's beautiful looking. It's like going into IKEA, say, and having each space be customized and personalized by designers. And then donors come in, and they just buy stuff that they like, you know. And there's also a silent auction for art auction, for art pieces. And those are really expensive art pieces as well. All those things, all those high-end stuff, were donated to Housing Works. I'm working to get those donations. So I'm calling companies and potential donors to ask to donate furniture for Housing Works. And then we sell them. So pretty much that's like all 100% profit. You know, we didn't spend any money other than paying, you know, people who work to donations and who arrange things. But I'm a volunteer. So as a volunteer, Housing Works is an amazing way to raise money and to also raise awareness about the issue that Housing Works is working for. So all the money that is raised from this fundraiser event will go to this new building that they're planning to build, a home that will serve 30 people living with HIV and AIDS that needs a home. So it will serve them and link them to appropriate medical services and counseling services and all that. Housing Works is a pretty amazing organization. It does this fundraiser every year. Last year, it raised $800,000 with this event. And our goal this year is to raise $1 million. So I'm volunteering there. It feels amazing. You know, the more I volunteer and this stuff, I know I'm being like pretty lazy right now in terms of I don't have a job. And, you know, I'm not really doing too much other than those 2 days volunteering at Housing Works. But it's a great lesson to me to be able to wake up and just do things, not because it helps me. I mean, it does help me have this experience and to kind of meet people and to be part of this nonprofit world. It helps in that regard, but it's not for my survival. And that's an incredible feeling. And the idea of having to work for money, I'm really spoiled in that way because I've never, in all the jobs I had, I'm really lucky, I guess. In every single job I've had, I've never felt like, except for the most recent one, I never felt like I wake up to go to work and I was like, oh God, I have to go to work. I didn't feel like that. Normally, I would never feel that. I would go to work because I enjoy doing the work. And most recently, that happened, you know? The thing that everybody else feels when they wake up to go to work, like, oh, I want to stay and just keep sleeping, you know? That is a normal feeling for most people. But that feeling was a recent hit for me. Like, oh God, like I don't want to go to work. So I ended up quitting that job, right? I'm such a spoiled, arrogant kid. But ended up quitting. And here I am. Now I'm volunteering. I'm learning more about myself through this process. Really, like, I just have this weird wish. Like, I wish I was rich or born rich. Not because I want to be rich, not because I want to spend all that money, because I don't want to be working for money. I just want to be working to do the stuff that I enjoy working, to do the things that I believe is the right thing to do. That's kind of my wish. I don't know, it's just pretty much wishful thinking right now, but that's where I'm at. And sometimes, you know, some of these days, I wake up, I'm just like, I feel like an 18-year-old kid who's, you know, who is pretty much done with high school. You know that transition period, that summer, after high school, before college? I feel like that's where I'm at right now. Much of my past life experiences, they just kind of feel like a blur, where it's just like, you know, I still feel so young. I still feel like I don't know anything, that I don't have any valuable experience to offer. I think that's what kind of scares me when I'm applying to jobs right now, is I feel like I don't have much to say. Like, hey, here, this is my resume. I had a year of experience at this organization. I had a year doing this. I had 4 months doing this. And yeah, that's what I have to show to you. I feel like such an inexperienced person who's not qualified for a lot of different jobs. And I want to like experience so much. You know what they say about, you know, college grads, they're book smart, but they're not really street smart or common sense smart. I think that kind of applies to me. I don't have like the life skills that people have, that normal people or average people have. You know, I wish I had a lot more of those experiences. I wish I had experience like, you know, bartending or being a cashier at a fast food place. You know, just regular experience, like those kind of things, just run-of-the-mill type of things. I'm going to try, I suppose, but it's a difficult thing for me because I am overqualified for those things. I don't feel like a lot of employers would consider me simply because, like, you have a college degree with this, like, and you want to be a dishwasher in a restaurant. That's really fishy. It's really odd. Like, why? You know, that would be interesting. You know, I wouldn't mind being a hardworking dishwasher. Don't know how long term that would be. You know, how long I could keep that up. But it's a weird transition period, just because I know I'm going to be entering grad school in the fall, which is going to add more to my depth. But I'm really not concerned about my debt currently, because I'm able to make the monthly payment right now, and I'm gonna accrue more debts after I graduate grad school. But in my line of work, if I pass through grad school, and because my field is during school is something that hooks me up with an internship, and that counts as valuable experience, and that internship could definitely turn into something that's, you know, a job or something that connects me to a job after I graduate. And master's in social work in New York City would mean a lot. So that's why I guess I'm feeling a little too complacent at this point. So I'm just waiting for that. But I know, I feel like I need to push myself harder. So there is this inner struggle in me to be like, this is like the best time of my life where I'm working or volunteering, because that's what I love doing. Because I believe in it and I'm doing what I believe in. That's always been kind of my motto. To do what I believe in and to believe in what I do. Doing what I believe in has always been the easy thing. And believing in what I do has been the tougher aspect of that model. But, you know, right now, that's what I'm doing. I'm volunteering. There is no money involved. It's an affordable. I don't spend that much money on pretty much anything. My PlayStation 3 had a yellow light of doom. So there goes that entertainment thing. But I'm... You know, I have an online thing that I pay $10 a month, which is really affordable, and I'm able to play all these kinds of games. So I'm able to have a lot of awesome time. You know, it's really the best time in my life. Ironically enough, unemployed. And it sounds like the most laziest thing to say. I feel like there is this ingrained attitude that Americans feel like everyone else should have, that, like, if you're not working, you know, you're lazy and you're a nobody to society and you're a burden on society. I think there's that ingrained attitude, and that's kind of ingrained in me as well, which I'm, you know, that's why there is this inner struggle. And I agree, you know, I should be doing something and working as hard as I can, but, you know, that's kind of where I'm at right now. That's my life. Do I have anything more to say on that? I guess that's really all I gotta say right now. I'm hoping to become... Oh, right. Yeah, I'll save that for another video, but... Yeah, so that's just it. Wow, it's been an hour. I've done it. So, yeah, I'm a pretty talkative person, it turns out. I hope you know, if you were able to stick to this or skip to this part at the end of the video. And if I do have any viewers... I kind of doubt that would happen, but if I have any viewers, tell me what you thought. Just if you want to give me a topic that I should talk about, you know, any questions you have for me, I will definitely answer that in the next video. Because, you know, an hour to talk is quite a bit of time. And I'll have a different tie, I'll have a different shirt, spice it up a bit, and just talk about a bunch of different things. But... yeah, thanks for watching. Here has been an hour of Kwonmunism. And now you have become more Kwonmunist than an hour before. Cheers.